Welcome to the first tutorial of our series, where we embark on a journey to understand the world of electric circuits, powering everything from our trusty gadgets and appliances to the vast infrastructure that drives our daily lives are millions of electrical circuits. These circuits are the hidden powerhouses fueling the technology that shapes our world. In this series, we'll break down the concepts associated with circuit analysis step by step, beginning with the fundamentals and gradually building our knowledge to tackle more advanced topics. Before we begin, I want to thank our friends at Digilent, whose invaluable support and collaboration have made this series possible. So, whether you're in high school or college and are just starting, or are looking to refresh your understanding, this series is designed for you. In this first tutorial, we'll explore the foundational concepts of electricity and circuit theory, and we'll continue to build on this foundation in the following tutorials. If you'd like to see a written tutorial with more in-depth information, head over to our website and check out the detailed tutorial linked in the description below. Now, let's dive into some key terminology and concepts related to electric circuits. So, scientists and engineers love analogies, and they often help in simplifying complex ideas. In this tutorial, we'll do just that by using a simple water analogy to explain voltage and current. Now, imagine a water tank placed at some height above the ground. As you know, objects at a certain height have potential energy, and the water in this tank is no exception. This energy associated with the water due to its elevation is analogous to voltage, which represents the energy per unit charge at a specific point. Voltage is a measure of the energy available in a circuit to do work, in this case, moving a charge from one point to another. Mathematically, this is expressed as V equals dW over dQ, where V is the voltage difference, W is the energy, Q is the charge, and the differentials dW and dQ are taken as the change in energy and charge between two points in space. Voltage is represented by the letter V and is measured in volts, denoted by an uppercase V as well. It's important to note that in electrical circuits, we often care about voltage differences between two points rather than the absolute voltage. This is because this voltage difference is what drives the flow of electric charges in a circuit. However, when a voltage is expressed as an absolute value instead of a difference, it is generally assumed to be taken with relation to ground or 0 volts. Now that we've explored voltage as an electrical potential energy, analogous to the energy stored in water held above the ground, let's delve into the concept of current. Returning to our water tank analogy, let us imagine that the water in the tank is held in place by a valve or gate. The water in the tank has its own energy, just as voltage exists, even when the charges are not in motion. When we open the valve at the bottom, allowing the water to flow, this represents the concept of current. More precisely, the volume of water passing through a specific point, like the valve, corresponds to what we call current. In electrical circuits, current represents the rate of flow of electric charge. Mathematically, we express this relationship as I equals dQ dt, or dQ over dt, where I is current, Q is charge, and t is time. In this equation I equals dQ dt, we're essentially measuring the flow of charge over time, where dQ is the change in charge over a specific time interval given by dt. Current is represented by the letter I, and it is measured in amperes, represented by an uppercase A. Using the water tank analogy, you can think of voltage more intuitively, like the potential energy associated with water at different heights. The greater the height, the greater the potential energy. This is comparable to a higher voltage, which provides a greater push for electric charges through the circuit. And this electric charge flow is essentially what we call current. Along with voltage and current, there is another factor that plays a role in electric circuits: resistance. In electrical circuits, resistance acts like an obstacle in a water pipe. Imagine a water pipe with a section that's narrower than the rest. When water flows through this narrow section, it encounters more resistance compared to the wider parts of the pipe. In electrical circuits, resistance works similarly. It's like the narrow part of the pipe hindering the flow of electric current in a circuit and causing it to slow down. Resistance is represented by the letter R and is measured in ohms, which is denoted by the Greek letter omega. Now that we've discussed these fundamental electrical circuit terms, let's quickly review their SI units as well. The SI unit for voltage is volt, the SI unit for current is ampere, and the SI unit for resistance is ohms, again, represented by the Greek letter omega. Another fundamental idea that helps us understand electric circuits is the concept of passive sign convention. Passive sign convention helps us consistently define the direction and polarity of both current and voltage in passive components, where passive components are the circuit elements that are capable of storing or dissipating energy, but not generating it. Let's explore this idea with an example. This is a typical two-terminal electric circuit element or component. It has current, labeled as I, flowing through it, and there's a voltage difference, V, across its terminals. In electrical circuits, both current and voltage can take on positive or negative values. Voltage, representing the relative energy difference between two points, uses its sign or polarity to indicate which point has a higher energy level. Similarly, current can also have either positive or negative signs. These signs help us determine the direction of its flow within a circuit. The universal sign convention for passive components assumes the sign of the current relative to the voltage. According to the passive sign convention, a positive current always enters the circuit element at a point with a higher voltage. A circuit element following the passive sign convention would look something like this. While this is an example of a circuit element that does not follow the passive sign convention. In circuit analysis, you can assume a reference direction for either voltage or current. If your assumption is correct, then you get a positive value. And if you get a negative value, it simply means that your assumption doesn't align with the actual direction, and you just need to flip the directions. To summarize, firstly, it's important to ensure that the positive current enters the circuit element at the higher voltage side. Secondly, when you analyze a circuit, you can arbitrarily assume a reference direction for either voltage or current. A positive value means that the assumed direction is correct, and a negative value means that the actual direction is the opposite of what was assumed. So far, we've seen that circuit diagrams often represent voltage polarities using the plus or positive and minus or negative signs. Another way to represent voltage polarities is using what's known as the double subscript notation. To understand this better, let's revisit our previous example of a typical two-terminal electrical circuit element with a voltage V across it and a current I flowing through it. This time, let's label the terminals A and B. Assuming that the voltage at A is higher than that at B, and that the current is flowing from A to B, we can denote the voltage across the element as VAB. This is known as the double subscript notation. In other words, VAB is the voltage at point A with respect to point B, with point A being at a higher potential. However, this holds true only if the sign of the voltage is positive. In our example, if VAB has a negative value, say VAB is equal to negative 6 volts, this simply means that our initial assumption was incorrect and that B is actually at a higher potential. So our circuit element can be accurately represented as VBA, with point B at a higher potential. You may observe that the potential difference observed from point A to B, or top to bottom in this case, is simply the negative of the potential difference from point B to A. Hence, we can say that VAB equals negative VBA. Okay, now let's talk about an essential aspect of electrical circuits, power. You often see gadgets or appliances with a wattage or power rating, but what does this mean? Power, or electric power, is defined as the rate at which work is done or energy is transferred in an electric circuit. Mathematically, it's expressed as the product of the current passing through an element and the voltage difference across that element, or more simply, voltage times current equals power. This equation is written as a function of time because power is calculated at a specific instant. And finally, power is measured in watts, which is denoted by an uppercase W. Power in a circuit can be either absorbed or generated by a circuit element, but how do we figure out which one of the two is occurring? This is where the passive sign convention helps us. When the signs of voltage and current align with the passive sign convention, the element absorbs power, like a resistor heating up when current flows through it. Conversely, when the signs of voltage and current don't align with the passive sign convention, the element is generating power. In this case, the element provides electrical energy to the circuit, just like a solar panel produces electricity when exposed to light. Let's look at this with an example. Consider a typical circuit element with a voltage difference V across points A and B and a current, I, passing through it. The current enters the circuit from the direction of higher voltage. As you can see, this follows the passive sign convention and hence is absorbing power. However, if you look at this example, you can see that the signs for current and voltage do not obey the passive sign convention. Here, the positive current is not entering from the direction of higher voltage or positive polarity, and hence this element is generating power. So, we covered a substantial amount about the basics of electrical circuits. We began by defining voltage and current in terms of electrical charge, while introducing the concepts of resistance and power. We also explored the importance of the passive sign convention in understanding whether a circuit element is absorbing or generating power. We also briefly touched upon the relationship between current and voltage while talking about the importance of consistent sign conventions. Now, we're ready to explore Ohm's law, which describes how current and voltage relate to each other, adding another familiar variable into the mix, resistance. Ohm's law is both the simplest and most fundamental principle in the world of electrical circuits, making it a cornerstone of electrical engineering and circuit analysis. So, stay tuned for our next tutorial where we'll delve deeper into Ohm's law and show you how to apply the concepts we learned today to analyze and solve real electrical circuits. Again, we want to thank our friends of CircuitBread at Digilent for their invaluable support, and the best way you can support us is to go check out all the powerful tools that Digilent has created to help engineers of all levels. As always, if you'd like to see a written tutorial with more in-depth information, please check out the accompanying write-up on CircuitBread.com. And if you found this video useful, helpful, whatever, give it a like, subscribe to our channel, and we will catch you in the next one. Take care. Hey, we hope you enjoyed the video. Did you know that CircuitBread.com also has a ton of other stuff, including free electronics and electrical engineering tools? Besides a scientific calculator, we have a few dozen other tools, including a delta Y calculator, LED resistor calculator, a binary, decimal, hexadecimal, and more converter, as well as a slew of other unit converters. Go check them out.